Father, we thank you that there is room at the cross. We ask that today that your Spirit touch our hearts and the hearts of those who are listening by live stream, and will bring to their mind and their heart the need for that personal relationship with you. Now, Father, we thank you for this time of the service where we can come together to worship you through our act of obedience by giving back to you that portion of income that you have given us, that tithe, the 10%. We ask, Lord, that you receive that from us. Bless it, multiply it, that Christ may be manifested through this part of your body. And Lord, I know that there are some that you have touched their hearts and their minds to give an offering, that part which is above and beyond the tithe. Lord, I ask that you receive their offering. Bless it and use it through this part of your body that Christ may be shared with this community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
I didn't put down a scripture for this one, but I think it's self-explanatory.
All the builders' tools are silent. No.
looked there for a second.
I heard the trumpet, I'm leaving.
Oh, man.
Let's go. Yeah.
Praise
amen.
The Lord. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Haven't heard that one in a while. I love that song.
Goes along with our times.
Yeah. Each step I take, though, that's always been one of my favorites. It's good. Okay. Well. Let's start with a prayer. Father, we do thank you so much that we have an opportunity to worship you, to praise you. Lord, we ask now that you speak to our hearts. Draw us into a closer fellowship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Okay. Well, sometimes in order for us to be satisfied, we need to understand and we need to know that we matter. We need to have that assurance in our heart, in our mind, that we really do matter. That we matter to one another. We matter to our family. We matter to God. We can't just know it intellectually. It needs to be more than that. We need to be convinced that we really do matter. That we matter to the Lord. Well, today is the fourth message of the series that we started on the shepherd and his sheep. We conclude this series today. The first three, do you remember, were based upon the 23rd Psalm. There are six verses there. We took basically two verses her message for that. Today, we are continuing with the subject, the shepherd and his sheep. But today, we're pulling the message from the 10th chapter of John, and it'll be verses 1 through 4. Yeah, that's what I've got there. 1 through 4, and then we'll jump over to verse 9. Okay, and hopefully as we study this today, we will begin to understand and we'll begin to see just how much we matter to Jesus, to the Lord. That's the main point of today. So if you would please stand with me in honor of our Lord and respect for our Lord as we read from the ever-living, eternally holy, inerrant, infallible, miraculously inspired, written word of God. And of course, for the God of the written word. John chapter 10, verse 1. I'm reading from the New King James Version today. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, and they know his voice. Skip on. on down to verse 9. I am the door. These are the words of Jesus, okay? I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. May God bless the reading of his word. Thank you. You may be seated. Our first point this morning is the shepherd keeps his sheep. Now, I want to start this morning by painting a picture in your mind, if I may. And I'd like for you to envision a sheepfold, pretty much like this one here on the screen. I hope you can, I'm going to kind of step over here out of the picture a little bit. I meant to bring my little red dot thing, but I forgot it. But you can see this is kind of what a sheepfold would look like, similar to this. And if you notice down here at the bottom right-hand corner, there's an opening right there. Now, you can't really see real good there, but that is a shepherd laying there in the opening of that sheepfold. You can kind of see the crook a little bit, okay, of his staff there on that, okay? So, now, build however you want to build that in your mind to picture it to where it's comfortable with you, where you can understand what I'm talking about here, okay? Now, as you can see, there is a small, narrow gate that enters into the sheepfold, which is made up of a wall that is there to protect the sheep that are inside, keeps the unwanted wolves and bears and whatever on the outside, and the sheep safely on the inside there. Now, the enclosure was guarded at night by the doorkeeper, and you can see him laying there, to prevent not just wolves and bears from coming in, but thieves as well to come in and to steal the sheep. Now, let's look again at verses 3 and 4. John 10, verses 3 and 4. It says, and the sheep hear his voice, and they call him by name, and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, and they know his voice. Now, because the shepherd has been talking to the sheep, when he talks to them, when he enters into the sheepfold and begins to talk to them, they recognize his voice. And because they recognize his voice, then those who belong to him, now let me interject, I don't think I've mentioned this yet, but a lot of times in a sheepfold, there's more than one herd that is in there. So when the shepherd walks in and he begins to talk to the sheep, they hear his voice, his sheep hear his voice, and they respond to him, and then he begins to go out. Now, if he's having trouble getting them out, remember last week what we said? The shepherd might pick up one of the babies of the ewes, put it on his shoulder, and he begins to walk out, and mama sheep goes, Wait, that's my baby. And she begins to follow him, and because she's following him, the others raise up, oh, where's she going? Okay, and here they go, okay? That's just the way the sheep do. And so that's how he gets them out. Okay, so they begin to follow him primarily because his voice is familiar. Now, if someone comes in and that none of the sheep belong to him, they're not going to respond and they're not going to follow him. Now, the analogy of this is that Christ is the shepherd who has been talking to the sheep. Remember, the Bible calls us sheep. Okay? He's talking to us, and he comes to us, and he calls us, and those of us who have been in communication with him recognize his voice, and we follow him. Now, what about all of these over here that pretend to have the gospel of Jesus Christ? And they say, you need to have all of this other stuff, and you can follow me, and we'll go through heaven's gates. Remember that? Okay.
Yeah.
And then they, some of them follow him because they have not been in communication with Jesus Christ. Folks, why every Sunday on these slides, why do you constantly see a lot of times the same one that says, read the Bible, study the Bible? This is why, so that you can know the voice of God. If you're watching television and you see this evangelist or whoever he might be, come on, and he begins to say things that really sound good, and then all of a sudden he says something, you go, ooh, wait a minute, I'm not sure about that. Then, if you have been in tune with God, with Christ, and studying his word, when they begin, and there are some that do kind of go the wrong way, okay? Not every one of them, I'm sorry, that I wish they were all true, but not every one of them are true to the total truth of the word of God. They give you just enough to grab a hold of your attention, and then they begin to run wild with it on that. So if you're really in tune with Christ, you're going to recognize when that person begins to deviate from the word of God. Now, in verse 7, Christ specifically states, I am the door. Then he repeats it again in verse 9. Okay, there should be a slide. There's 7. Okay. Now, he repeats it again in verse 9. But he says it with a little bit more clarification. He says, I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. You see, Jesus is both the shepherd and the door to the sheepfold. And this shepherd, sheepfold, is that is described by Jesus belongs exclusively to God's sheep. There's not any of the devil's sheep that are in his sheepfold, in God's sheepfold, okay? Therefore, all who have entered into this sheepfold have come in through the door, through Jesus Christ himself, a personal acknowledging acceptance of him. Now, let's take Noah's Ark. It had only one door.
Amen.
And that and the only way that the animals could get into the ark was through that one door. Okay? Christ, folks, is our ark. And just as the animals had to enter into their ark through one door, we, including those of you who are listening and watching by live stream, and us here, we can only enter through that one door, which is Jesus Christ himself. Christ, folks, is the only way, and I repeat, the only way that one can enter into the Lord's sheepfold. And you remember that song when we were kids? One door and only one, and yet its sides are two. Inside and outside, on which side are you? One door and only one, and yet its sides are two. I'm on the inside, on which side are you? Remember that song?
Yeah, I do.
I like that song. That's good. That is full of truth.
Amen.
What we're talking about right here. Every building has a door that goes without faith. I mean,
amen.
We've all it. However, if it didn't have a door, it would be a vault. Okay? And you would be sealed in death then. A door is also a means of separation. When this cold front came through last week, then you closed your front door, did you not? Made sure your windows were down and sealed, okay? And that kept the cold out so that you could keep the warmth inside. Now, we're on the inside, and the world is on the outside. There's a big difference, though, in my analogy here. You see, Jesus said that someday, some people who fully expected to enter into heaven would find the door to heaven shut in their face. Now remember, there's only one door, one way to get into heaven. Now, I made a statement there some of you may not agree with, but I do have a scripture to back it up. If you look at Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 23, let's see what Jesus says. These are his words. He says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven." Let me stop. What is the will of the Father in heaven? You believe in the name of Jesus Christ, that you profess him as your Savior and your Lord, okay?
Amen.
That's the will of the Father, that you believe in Jesus, who he is, okay? Now, let's look at the next verse, 22. "Many will say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonderful things in your name? Lord, I was a deacon in your church. Lord, I was president of the women's organization. Lord, I was president of the choir. Lord, I was faithful. I never missed a choir rehearsal. I was there and I supported the minister of music. I was there for him all the time." Look at verse 23. I will pull a little bit more on that just a second, okay? And then, verse 23, "I will declare to them, 'I never knew you, depart from me, who you who practice lawlessness.'" Now, I'm not saying being a member of the choir, you're going to go to hell because you're a member of the choir. But I'm saying if that is what you're basing your salvation on, because of the good things that you did, then no, that is not the way to get into heaven. And we'll talk about here in just a little bit more specifically on how you can know how that you know that you're going to heaven. Okay? Now, maybe you're asking yourself, "Pastor, how does this answer the question of whether or not we really matter? Because what you've said has kind of discouraged me a little bit and confused me." Well, let me answer the question, if you've had that question, this way. Have you ever thought about the benefits of being one of his sheep? What are the benefits? Have you ever thought about the benefits of one first, we receive the benefits of salvation. That's a pretty good benefit. Okay? John 10, verse 9 says, I am the door. If any man enters through me, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever thought about the word saved, or what it means? The word saved means that we are reconciled to God. Now, in other words, we finally experience what God intended for us to have. Please understand, though, being saved was no cheap blessing. Being saved was not purchased in some cheap manner. It wasn't bought at basement bargain prices. Five times Christ says, I lay down my life for the sheep.
Amen.
These sheep were purchased at a very high cost. Folks, those of you that can truly say with every ounce of energy and belief in your heart, yes, I am a born-again believer, redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. You are His sheep, and the price that Christ paid for you was not cheap.
Amen.
By any means.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, I don't know if you really thought about this before. In the Old Testament, sheep died for the shepherd. Think. What did they do every year?
Passover.
At Passover. What happened every year at the Passover? The sheep died for the shepherd. In the New Testament, folks, the shepherd died for the sheep.
Amen.
And it was voluntary. The sheep didn't have a choice. They were forced into it. But the shepherd, he was voluntary. He volunteered.
Amen.
Willingly coming. He said, no man taketh my life from me. He gave it.
Yeah.
You'll notice in the scripture it says he breathed his last. He didn't die. He gave his spirit up. Now, here is where Christ, the good shepherd, parts company with other shepherds. An ordinary shepherd would never volunteer to be killed in order that the sheep may continue to graze grass. Okay? Christ could have called 10,000 angels. I love that song.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free.
Amen.
Woo! I like that song.
Amen.
Okay. I'll keep singing there. Blah, blah, blah.
Amen.
Okay. You see, he could have to deliver him, but he did not. The dark Good Friday, Christ said, this time the wolf wins. He was a substitutionary death. He said, I lay down my life for the sheep. No other shepherd would ever do that. This shepherd is different. He dies for the sheep. Thankfully, his death was temporary. And he took it up again. The wolf won on what we call the crime. But then comes Sunday.
Amen.
Oh, Dr. Lockridge is in Lockridge. Hey. Oh, if you ever get to hear a recording of him singing that, woo, man, that is one of the most powerful messages I have ever heard. Dr. Lockridge was a black preacher, and boy, could he make the hair on the back of your neck stand up. Whoa, it was good. Anyway, then comes Sunday.
Amen.
All right. And no longer was the wolf the victor, but Christ, the King, the Lion of Judah, he was victorious.
Amen.
At that time. Now, that was just the first benefit. The second benefit, John 10:10. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. Now, what his sheep receives is not just eternal existence. It is a quality of life, folks. It is a special, unique relationship with God himself. We have life with Christ. But not only that, we have pasture, and it is abundant. Okay? We are now owned by God, and what he has, we have access to. In fact, all that there is of God now lives within us.
Amen.
Within you as a child, a child of God. Everything that there is of God lives within you. Now, that blows my mind. I can't even begin to comprehend and wrap my brain right there. So I don't try. I just believe what the Bible says there and just go on. And he reveals to me little by little, as I need to understand a little bit more, then he helps me understand just a little bit more. Now, most of the time, ordinary sheep are taken care of by a hired hand. He's paid a stipend, so to speak, each day for taking care of the sheep. But when he sees a wolf coming, I guarantee you he's going to run the other way. Verse 12 says, he who is the hireling is not a shepherd. who is not the owner of the sheep. Behold, he seeth the wolf coming, and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters the sheep.
Amen.
So much for the hired man.
Amen.
He's not going to stay there and die because of that. If you ask Christ about his wealth, he will say that his people are the richest of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Ask him about his jewels, and he will say, they shall be mine in the day. Ask him where his treasure is, and he will say, the Lord's portions are his people. The wealth, we are part of the wealth of God, of Jesus. He died for us. That makes us wealthy, folks. Very, very wealthy. his sheep matter so much for you.
Amen.
Say you go out here and buy, something expensive. Very, very expensive. What comes to your mind?
Groceries.
Other than groceries.
Yeah. Rolls Royce.
More expensive than
Rolls Royce.
Than groceries. You know, I got you there. That's good. Okay. Well, let's say above and beyond that. I mean, it's a something maybe you used to dream of. I remember when we were in Amway, they were always telling us, dream about that Cadillac. Dream about whatever it was that you were there, you know. And we would dream. That dream never came true.
A Rolls Royce.
Well, yeah, just and let's say that whatever it is that you're thinking of that is extremely expensive and possibly in the back of your mind, maybe I kind of wish, that'd be so neat if I could have something like that. What if some punk came up with his keys, walked up to the side of your
Rolls Royce,
Rolls Royce and just went. That would be
death penalty.
That would make you very, very angry. And you would do everything that you could to prevent something like that happening because of the cost that it cost you.
Amen.
We are the most precious things in the world in God's creation. We are more valuable, folks, than Jupiter, Pluto, and all of those galaxies, the thousands of galaxies that they're finding as the Hubble begins to look into the vastness of space. We are more valuable than all of that put together. And Jesus paid the price for you, one person, so that you could experience and have eternal life with Him. So that you, when we step over into eternity, where we can have the joy of actually seeing that 934,000 millionth galaxy.
Amen.
Out there. I like to use my imagination sometimes. I don't know if you've noticed that.
A lot.
Amen.
Life is abundant, and we have it abundantly. Third benefit, we have the assurance that we matter. Yes, we receive the benefit of salvation and also receive the benefits of significance. Because we really do matter. Jesus takes care of us. Verse 12. I said that already. Haven't I? No, I haven't. There it is. Okay. He who is the hireling is not a shepherd. He is not the owner of the sheep. But behold, he seeth the wolf coming. Leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them. I just flat jumped to that third point. That's what I've been talking about. I jumped over there. Okay, now, you see, when we get to heaven, it's not going to be anytime soon. It better not be anytime soon. But Francisco, when you walk through those gates, those pearly gates, you understand what I'm saying? Okay? You know what Jesus is going to do? He's going to say, "Hola, Francisco! ¿Cómo estás, amigo?" Good end. Yeah. Yeah. He will know you by name, Francisco. He will know you by name.
Amen.
Now, I went ahead and used the Spanish because some of my Spanish pastors that are friends say that when we get to heaven, we're going to be talking in Spanish anyway. Yeah, no. So
we'll understand it anyway.
But God knows every one of you who are His sheep. And He will call you by name. I kind of got sidetracked there in a lost place. I don't know. Okay, the fourth, I think, is the next one there, isn't it? Pass. Go ahead and bring it up. There it is, yeah. Okay, we also have the benefit of security. Jesus said, "No man can pluck me out of my Father's hand." The Scripture also says that every one of us have been given to Jesus. Okay? And as you study the Scripture, you know that it's through the power of the Holy Spirit that we are drawn to Him. And we respond to Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. We say yes or we say no. And once we have said yes and really, really meant what we said, we are His child. And nobody can pull us out of the hand of God. We are His. In Luke chapter 10, verses 27 through 29, He says, "My sheep hear My voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give eternal life to them, and they shall never perish. That's a verse of security right there. Once you've given your heart to Him, you're His, and you're His sheep, and you shall never perish. That means you'll never go to hell because you're His sheep, and you'll be in heaven. The verse goes on. It says, and no one shall snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. Excuse me. What are the chances that one of these sheep shall fall between the fingers of Jesus?
No chance. No.
Not a chance at all. Mm-hmm. Not a bit. In fact, it'd be zilch to negative 200 or whatever, you know. That's never going to happen. And the ordinary shepherd might not be able to win against the wolf. A group of shepherds might not be able to win against a pack of wolves. But I guarantee you, Jesus is greater than that. And He will protect us from the wolves at all costs and hazards. Can we snatch ourselves out of our Father's hand? No, we cannot. Do we do some pretty dumb and stupid things?
Yes.
Yeah, we do. We really do.
What scripture was that again?
Yeah.
No, I lost the sight. Was it Luke what?
Can we do dumb and stupid things?
What is the sight?
The scripture was Luke 27 to 29.
Luke 10.
Okay,
thank you.
I'm sorry, yeah. Luke 10, verses 27 to 29. And verse 29 is the one that says that He is greater than all, and no one can snatch Him out of the Father's hand.
Amen.
Okay. All right, now. We can and do some dumb things at times. And we do sin, unfortunately, from time to time. But we can never sin out of the grace of God. He is always there. His grace is greater than any sin that we have. Doesn't mean that He won't punish us if we do sin, because He will. Remember when we talked about the sheep that kept wandering off and going astray? And if he kept doing it, what did the shepherd do? He would break his leg in punishment, and then he had to carry that sheep as he healed, and he built a relationship back then with the sheep. And the sheep then would never wander off again. That's what we need to keep in mind. God is always there for us. The question, of course, is how can we be sure that we are God's sheep? Remember, there are many people in this world who think that they are God's sheep, but they are not. Remember what I read in Matthew a while ago? Okay, many will say, Lord, Lord. He'll say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, for I never knew you. Some are in the wrong fold, and that fold might even be labeled a church. I'm going to step out here. There are some churches, organizations, like the Jehovah's Witnesses, like the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and some others, that folks, the Jesus they worship is not the Jesus of the Bible. Because Jesus, according to the Latter-day Saints, had a brother, and his name was Lucifer. That's not biblical at all. You might find it in the Book of Mormon, but that's not the Bible. Okay? okay? So you've got to study the Bible yourself and know. And as you study it, you hear the voice of God, and you have more and more assurance in your heart who you are and who Jesus Christ is. How can we know for sure? Well, first, you must be convinced that Christ is the Good Shepherd, that He is the Son of God, and that He did everything that needs to be done for you in order to become one of God's sheep.
Amen.
He's already done it. You've got to believe that.
Amen.
You must, and I emphasize, must admit that you are a sinner and need Christ in your life.
Amen.
Next, you must believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and that He died for your sins, past, present, and future. You must believe that He was buried, and on the third day He rose from the dead and is seated alive at the right hand of the Father.
Amen.
In heaven.
Amen. He lives.
In essence, folks, you must believe and accept His life, Christ's life, His death, His resurrection, as the sacrifice and payment for your sins. That's a must. No deviation in any way from any of that. Your faith, folks, must be a personal faith. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice." Folks, that is personal. Your faith must be conscious. Your faith must know His voice.
Amen.
In other words, your parents cannot make a decision for you. Your church cannot make a decision for you.
Right.
Folks, your pastor cannot make that decision for you. What has to be done in order for you to be in God's sheepfold? Remember, Christ has done it all already. There's nothing else that can be done, needs to be done, in any way, form, or fashion. The next, what you must do then is believe it. You must believe what I just said about Christ having done it all. You cannot work yourself into the sheepfold. You cannot make yourself into a sheep. Only God can do that. And the only time He does that is if you confess and believe that Jesus Christ died for you, was buried, and rose on the third day. As sacrifice and payment for your sins. Folks, will you trust Christ and what He's done for you? Will you receive His free gift? Will you receive Him into your heart and into your life? And will you follow Him into the sheepfold? Will you, who are already born-again believers, stop being stubborn and bullheaded and rebellious and follow His voice, His teaching, His word, and what it says. Not what you think it says or what you want it to say, but what it says. The choice is yours. I said a while ago, your pastor cannot make that decision for you. Oh, to my Lord Jesus Christ, I wish that I could.
Amen.
I'm doing all that I can right now, pleading that you commit your heart and your life totally to Jesus Christ. This side of eternity will never gain what needs to be, but we keep working for that. Working didn't save you. Please don't misinterpret what I'm saying. We keep looking toward the goal, following Him, His teachings and all. And then we will continue on throughout eternity. Will you trust Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? We're fixing to sing a song, Only Trust Him. And I'm asking that right now that you just pray in your heart and your mind. Say, Lord Jesus, please forgive me. I've really messed up. Forgive me. Cleanse me. Come into my heart and life and be my Savior. Be Lord of my life. For those of us that are already born again believers, but we've kind of backslidden, or a whole lot backslidden, then I'm asking that you say, please forgive me and cleanse me, so that I may walk afresh and new with you, restoring to me the joy of my salvation. Will you do that today? And then come tell me. That's important. Jesus said in Matthew that if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you don't confess me before men, I'm not going to confess you before my Father who is in heaven. It's so important that we hold true what we say that we believe. And will you do that? As we stand and as we sing, you make that decision for Christ now, and then come and tell us.